I'd like to call this workshop meeting to order. I'd like to welcome everyone. As you all know, Mayor Sammy Phillips is now a proud grandfather. And so we congratulate him and his wife and his family. I know he's very excited today and wanted to be with us tonight, but as you can understand, he's still floating in the air and we'll see him very soon. So without further ado, we have in front of you the proposed agenda, and we'll entertain a motion to adopt the agenda.
Moved. Second. To adopt.
Motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay, motion carries. I'll turn it over to Dr. Richard Woodruff to lead us off. Dr. Woodruff.
Good evening. Appreciate you all being with us tonight in the workshop. As you can see on the screen, there are three items that we're going to be discussing tonight. The first item is a downtown circulation study, which the MPO and staff worked through a consultant. Mr. Davenport, who's here tonight, will make the primary presentation. At the conclusion of that, we're actually going to blend into item number two. Because when you deal with downtown circulation, part of our future with circulation is also how do we want to redevelop the area generally between City Hall and down to the courthouse. And then, of course, we have been discussing for some time the project of the Tourist Development Authority, that's the wayfinding program. I asked Glenn what a wayfinding program was. He said, for my purposes, that's signs. So hopefully tonight we'll be able to go through all of these. However, we do have a veterans presentation this evening, and we know that the council will want to spend some time before the meeting with the veterans. So our goal is to try to conclude the workshop by approximately 6:30. Thank you. This time I'm going to turn it over to Anthony to introduce Mr. Davenport.
Thank you, Dr. Woodruff. Good evening, Mayor Pro Tem, members of council. It's a pleasure to be here with you tonight. As Dr. Woodruff mentioned, we've been working with Mr. Davenport and Mr. Dan Cumbo here from Davenport Engineering. Excuse me, I think it's Davenport Transportation now, right?
Nope, you got it right.
Davenport Engineering on a downtown circulation study. Over the past year, John and Dan have done some excellent work for us. And I think that you'll see that as they go through their presentation. Our presentation tonight is going to take on three parts. First, John is going to take you through the technical aspects of the study, what we evaluated, and of course, what our recommendations are. And then I'm going to talk to you a little bit about how we would like to create an ongoing dialogue regarding downtown, not only the transportation improvements, but the streetscape improvements as well. And then finally, the third part of the presentation is going to be a review of some of the previous recommendations that have been made for New Bridge Street. And really, that's just a primer to get us into the ongoing conversation about downtown that I was talking about. So without any further ado, I'll turn it over to Mr. Davenport, and he'll take us through the beginning of the presentation.
Well, thank you for having us here. Anthony, again, my name is John Davenport. I'm the president and owner of John Davenport Engineering, or we've shortened it down, just down to Davenport. We have done the KFC, Kentucky Fried Chicken, KFC, back and forth, but we've shortened it down. Dan Cumbo is, I'm out of the Winston-Salem office. That's where our headquarters is. Dan Cumbo runs the Wilmington office, and he's the one that has worked directly with Anthony a lot of this project. But because of its importance, I certainly wanted to come down and share our results with you personally. So we've got a slide presentation here. Am I going the right direction?
Wrong way.
I'm going the wrong direction.
Here we go. And you're in traffic engineering?
We need some wayfinding.
We need some wayfinding.
See, there's no arrow to go the other way. All right, so that's a nice cover page.
All right, so again, to try to give you a little bit of background, Our scope was a comprehensive transportation study to consider all modes of transportation. We wanted to improve specifically downtown circulation, interconnectivity, and the area's overall cohesiveness and vibrancy. We'll talk about that. And promote a cohesive, interconnected downtown core consistent with existing and future land uses and the city's goals and downtown master plan. So that's a summary of the direction we were called to work on. Just a little bit about the study area here. As you can see, we've got several streets that are highlighted. This slide looks a little bit different. Okay, there we go. Ah, it's a build.
Mm-hmm. You guys got fancy on me.
Dan didn't tell me this was going to happen. One area that was a study focus area was the one-way section of Court Street. And you can see that highlighted there. We had sight distance challenges at Old Bridge and Court. We also were, you know, we took a look at traffic calming and bike and pedestrian enhancements along Johnson Boulevard, New Bridge Street, and Cheney and Railroad. We'll talk about all those. There were some safety and operational improvements that we were to consider there at Cheney and Court. And also some safety and operational improvements down at, it's hard to read those streets.
College. Bayshore.
Yeah, Bayshore. So we're going to talk about all those. And if you have questions as we go through the slides, please feel free to interrupt me.
What is sight distance?
Sight distance is, so if you can look at the Italian coffee, and I'm going to have a blow up of this. Okay. When you pull up the intersection, you want to be able to see a vehicle. There's a certain distance before you feel like you can pull safely out. So at this intersection, that sight distance is not sufficient. And then also, I forgot Riverwalk Parks, access to special events. Okay, so I'm not going to read all those because we're going to cover these in sections of the study goals. First of all, we wanted to improve the connection between Old Bridge and New Bridge. Sight distance, again, they improve that at the intersection of Court and Old Bridge. Evaluate the impacts on downtown circulation based on the potential of converting Court Street to a pedestrian mall and other alternatives. Provide lane reductions along Johnson Boulevard to provide opportunities for enhanced bike and ped accommodations and streetscaping, and then provide recommendations to enhance streetscaping, pedestrian and bike facilities, and transit accommodations in general. Highlighted here on the screen, you have Old Bridge and New Bridge, and that's the current connection that we have. We've got a one-way situation on Court, and that's the traffic pattern that we have connecting the two streets. We looked at three alternatives. Alternative one, Old Bridge Street, we had the extension open, but we converted Court to a two-way, and we had always stop control at Old Bridge, and Court. New Bridge and Court would remain two-way. And then there's a mini roundabout at further to the west.
East, yes.
Okay. And the difference between a mini roundabout, I want to make sure everyone understands that you've probably seen the larger roundabouts with the big islands and whatnot. A mini roundabout is a lot smaller. It does still have the circular island, but for larger vehicles, they can just drop right over it. Fire engines and whatnot. So it's not as big, doesn't take up as much right away. All right, alternative two, we looked at closing a section of Old Bridge Street, the extension, creating kind of a pedestrian mall feel. Then again, you'd have two-way traffic on Court, still have the all-way stop, and up to a four-way all-way stop at New Bridge. So that was the second alternative we looked at. And then the third one was just a closure of Court Street altogether. Between New and Old Bridge. Any questions? Anybody have a guess of what we recommended?
One or two.
If you guess number one, you're right.
Oh.
I like this thing. That was the selected alternative by the stakeholders. And here's why. It provides improved circulation and connectivity for downtown. So you've got the Court Street extension over across to Marine. And so this allows for good connections here. Better utilization of infrastructure, again, of that connection. Improved route from Marine Boulevard provides alternative route for connectivity of Old Bridge and New Bridge. So you've got an alternative for connection. And provides improved traffic flow to the park. Remember, that was one of our areas that we're concerned about, the Riverwalk Park and several of the other points of interest, and provides an alternative route for exiting traffic from the park to relieve congestion for the special events.
So, John, if you don't mind, I'd like to interject that really what the stakeholders felt is that this is an opportunity to create a second Main Street for downtown. You know, right now the Main Street is New Bridge Street, and that runs east and west. by opening up Court Street to two-way traffic again, you could get another Main Street type of feel between our primary north and south activity centers. You know, so at the end of Court, we have Sturgeon City and the park, et cetera. At the very northern end, we also have the Onslow Inn site, which at some point in time is going to be another activity center. So creating this secondary Main Street provides really nice interconnectivity between those activity centers.
Who are the stakeholders?
The stakeholders are primarily city staff. So we're talking about folks from public services, development services, of course, transportation as well. We had representation from the city manager's office as well.
No business from the area, businessmen from the area or the county?
Not to this point.
Okay.
Not to this point, but that's certainly a next step that we could take.
No residents?
Not to this point, sir, no.
I have a question. We had a downtown committee that was made up of several of us and the mm-hmm. county representatives. And part of the discussion was the sort of the potential realignment of New Bridge Street mm-hmm. and Old Bridge Street to make it flow a lot better than it is today.
Yes, sir.
Is that off the table? Is that not possible?
Well, I'm not saying that it's off the table. Anything is possible, certainly, but the challenge that our group had with that particular option is that you'd have to acquire a bunch of property. You'd have to buy several buildings in the vicinity of New Bridge Street. Excuse me, John.
Oh, you're fine.
And I'm not drawing. Just hit the backward arrow. You'd have to acquire a number of buildings in that particular area in order to make that happen. You could certainly do it. It would be a lot more expensive than what we're recommending. Essentially, you get the same traffic pattern because what we're recommending is a way to kind of increase the efficiency of that particular movement there. But if at some point those properties became available and it was important enough for us to realign that roadway, we could certainly do it.
Well, I know that we just, and Richard, maybe you could chime in on this, but there was a lot of conversation about that. Now, obviously, there's new boards and probably new people, but is that still something that we want to think about?
Yeah,
or
personally, I would say to you that in the long term, you do want to connect Old Bridge and New Bridge generally the way that Anthony has drawn it. I think what you should look at Mr. Davenport's proposal, though, is as an interim step.
Right.
You have, I believe it is four active businesses that are in that area right now. If any of those buildings came available over the next several years, I would certainly encourage council to buy them. You're probably looking, though, between acquisition and road construction at least $500,000 to $750,000 project. By doing some of the interim steps, which are shown in Mr. Davenport's report, I think you could improve the circulation, but I would not encourage council to give up on the ultimate goal of generally straightening the road out.
Thank you.
If we do have success, which I believe in a minute you're going to see some of the additional things that Mr. Davenport and others are going to be recommending for the four blocks generally here in front of City Hall. As this block and the other blocks become more successful, the pressure on these circuitous routes that are on the screen is going to increase. And with that, the time will become right for you to consider a more aggressive step. But I would ask Mr. Davenport if he agrees. He and I haven't discussed this. Would you agree on kind of a phased approach on this?
Yeah, I think that's the way to do it. If you go with a phased approach, and I'll just go back to what the alternative looks like. I'll go all the way back to one. I can blow up with that one. So the cost to implement something like this is very low. You do need to get the public involved. You do need to talk to businesses, clearly. You're going to have to do that with any of the scenarios you go with. But in this case, you're not buying right away. You won't have to condemn any properties. It's just a matter of paint striping, signs, and then that miniature roundabout, which is a relatively low cost change, and which actually doesn't have to be there. to make this work. It's an additive and enhancement, and it fits with some of the other stuff that we're going to show you. But, you know, in terms of fixing the connection, this helps do that in the interim. And still, and it's not a step backwards or sideways. I mean, all we're doing talking about signs and paint in the future, we can buy the buildings and reconnect the roof. That's an easy solution on paper, but a complex solution in terms of expense.
One of the things that we talked about as a group is that there's a lot of underutilized property in that general area. So if someone were to come in and buy a lot of that property, and I'm talking about in...
You want me to go forward?
Well, I'm trying to get my pen again. Yeah, okay. I'm talking about in this general vicinity here, and then this general vicinity here. So if someone were to come in and acquire a lot of those parcels and come to us with a redevelopment plan saying, okay, city, I want to do something impressive down in here. I want to build multi-story buildings, et cetera. Then that would be a perfect opportunity. You know, because one of the things that we didn't want to do as a group was to disrupt the downtown block that you already have here without having something else to go back into its place. So ultimately, like Dr. Woodruff said, this is going to be a very, the realignment would be more of a long-term type of strategy.
Now, the roundabout you mentioned, is that replace a stoplight or is there just a stop sign?
Yes, sir.
It replaces a stoplight.
And we have some more definitive, or I should say better illustrations as I go forward on that area. When we start talking about New Bridge. All right, so going again, you ask about sight distance. That's the picture blown up. You can see that it's difficult to see to the right, so you don't know what's coming. We've done some renderings of what that would look like. there are a number of positive things about putting in an always stop. One is you're going to minimize crashes. And the crashes that you would have would be much less severe. Pedestrian access is enhanced. Because when you get ready to cross the intersection, you're at equal footing with the vehicle. And in fact, they're supposed to stop if you're in a crosswalk anyway. But in this case, you've got a sign, so you have to stop anyway. So it's a much safer environment.
Before you leave that, as you know, Old Bridge Street is still under the jurisdiction of the Department of Transportation. We have talked to Robert Voss prior to him assuming his new position as regional engineer, and the DOT would be willing to deed that roadway system from Railroad all the way to Ann Street to the city. We were concerned that, why is that important? They are not in favor under their regulations of a four-way stop here. On the other hand, if it's under city jurisdiction, such as New Bridge Street is, then they basically take a hands-off position. So if we're going to move forward with this recommendation and the recommendation to open Court Street, we would need to get DOT's concurrence in deeding that street to the city. Now, the reason why we did not want it to go all the way out to the intersection of Old Bridge and Marine is because then the city would be responsible for the bridge. And we don't want to be responsible for that bridge. So Robert came to a compromise with us by saying that if in the future the city wanted to do something at this intersection, that he would certainly support the city taking ownership back to Ann Street. So just to know, that would be one of the logistic points we'd have to do.
And this, Dr. Woodruff, would not impact the reconstructing of the courthouse?
No, ma'am.
Okay.
No. Good point.
Then the thought would be that the construction of the courthouse would be ongoing for the next couple of years. So really, if we wanted to do something like this, we would wait until the construction of the courthouse is tapering off. While it's still kind of a construction area, we would go in there and do the improvements. So when the courthouse is done, so is the streetscape. And we have a very nice kind of corridor, newly revitalized corridor in that area. And to build off of one of Dr. Woodruff's points, Robert Voss was also very generous in saying, City, if you want to take over the maintenance of that street, I'll also give you a little bit of money to do so. So that's not a large, but it is a revenue source for us to potentially do some of this work out here.
All right. So moving on to Johnson Boulevard, currently 5-lane road with what people call suicide lane. It's a center turn lane. We were looking at how we could enhance the bike path and landscaping in general, essentially converting that to 4-lane divided by providing a planted median in the area where the suicide lane currently exists. That would allow us to have a 4-lane divided roadway, still maintaining bike lanes and additional landscaping, green it up, and also to fix or replace any pedestrian connections along sidewalks that are currently not in place or in disrepair. So that's the typical section for Johnson. Cheney is currently 4-lane undivided, very little traffic, does not warrant all that pavement anymore. And so what we've looked at is going to a 2-lane section with narrower lanes than what's out there, providing angle parking on one side and parallel parking on the other. And this would add parking to the area in general. And of course, we'd be able to do landscaping. There will be a couple of areas where you may want to create or keep auxiliary turn lanes, left turn lanes and whatnot, so we couldn't do it the whole corridor. But for a good chunk of it, we could make it look like this. And that could pretty much be done with a resurfacing project.
Some of those pavement markings out there are in such bad shape, we could probably just go ahead and restripe it without doing a whole lot of additional work.
And then a railroad street again. We, taking a look at it, we feel like the cross section is wide enough to provide 2 lanes and parallel parking on either side with landscaping.
And John, if I may interject real quickly, one of the reasons why we're able to recommend these improvements for all these corridors downtown, where you go from 4 lanes to 2 lanes or whatever the recommendation may be, is because there's a lot less traffic down here now that the Jacksonville bypass is open. You know, I was looking back in the old traffic count database, and in the late 90s, early 2000s, on Johnson Boulevard, we had about 55,000 cars a day. Okay? And today, we're lucky to see about 8,000 cars a day. So really, the Jacksonville bypass has had a huge impact on the travel patterns downtown, and it's freed up some capacity so that we can do some of these neat things.
Yeah, and it goes back to what downtowns were originally created for. So at some point, we needed to move a lot of traffic, and the roads went through town, so we had to make them as wide as possible. Now we don't try to move as much traffic through downtowns. The roads that are there are to provide access to the buildings that are there, but they're more of a place and just not a facility to move vehicles. So that's parking and areas for bikes and so on and so forth. There are a couple of areas that I pointed out earlier that we also asked to look at, Railroad and Court. Right now, great big, Dan tells me it's 55 feet of unmarked pavement out there. So it's a sea of asphalt that we don't need for traffic anymore. We've got some recommendations here on the right where we narrow that down, add some parking, and enhance pedestrian crossings. So that's clearly shown on that particular slide. A similar situation here with Shore and East Bay Shore. The roads just really didn't fit well together, disconnected. And so what we're proposing is to provide a continuous connection through there and in the course of doing that, enhance the pedestrian, add some more green space. The green area is what we're proposing to remove asphalt, which that's kind of contrary to my training as a traffic engineer, but that's what we're doing now. We're pulling up some of that stuff. But we don't need as much of it. Now, for the meat, I think of what a lot of you guys would be interested in is the new bridge plans. So lane reductions, enhanced bike and ped, streetscaping, and I want to spend some time on that. The highlighted area starting just up here at the fountain and heading to the west is the study area, and that's a shot right there, right outside of our where we are right now. Big wide road, not a lot of traffic on it. And so that's going to give us an opportunity to make some of the changes. We sat down with the committee. We had lots of ideas that were thrown out, and one of our folks, we have an office in Asheville, and one of the people that was working said, hey, you know, Hendersonville, they've got this main street where the road kind of meanders through there, and they presented that into the committee, and those folks liked it. If you look at this, this is actually an aerial shot of Hendersonville, very similar in terms of the amount of width between the downtown buildings. Had lateral shifts, and so what I mean by that, road snakes. And that what that does is slows traffic down. And it's better than speed bumps because, you know, your fire and emergency response don't like speed bumps. It slows down their response time. Your maintenance people don't like them because if it does snow, then they might hit the speed bump and it's a problem. And then, of course, speed bumps in general, people tend to speed up after they go over them. So this is another way of slowing traffic down without having to put obstacles in the road. And before I, and Dan told me to point out also with the crosswalks and bulb outs, so you'll see that in our plans. But this is what they did in Hendersonville. Took, you know, a while to make it develop to get to look the way it does. Here's a shot of what they have in their main street now. You can see the art locations and pedestrian crossings. So what we did was take a look at how can we do that on New Bridge. So this is essentially starting right outside. And what you see at Johnson Boulevard, you see a lot of green area that we're creating. Right now you have two left turn lanes turning on to New Bridge. You don't need all that now. So we're basically proposing two lanes, one each direction along New Bridge, and replacing the rest of that pavement with angled parking and areas for loading zones and for artwork. So that's a sketch up of what we have there. It's a miniature roundabout that we're proposing at North Bayshore.
That one's full size.
That's full size? Okay. There's enough room to put a full size in there, so that's what we're showing there.
And that would, again, replace the traffic signal?
Yes. Okay. That's what it says. New opportunities for green space. I remembered everything in the day. All right, so that's the kind of an existing shot. Looking into where we are on the right, and this is our rendering of what that could look like with those changes. Again, you see the lateral shift and the road weaving through town, but creating a more park-like experience. What this does is creates a place, so you're somewhere, you're not going through. As we proceed along the corridor, it's more of the same. You can see the angle parking in place and areas for artwork or patios. You know, there's, you know, some restaurants like the idea of being able to have some outside dining, and this creates the opportunity for that. And when you have really good weather, you put some tables out there and allow for that sidewalk dining.
Yeah, before you leave the graphic, one thing that we would also like to point out, since a lot of our buildings are in, well, let me say it this way. Our buildings do not have restaurants today. So in thinking about how you would redevelop New Bridge Street, we're not actually proposing that you would begin to install the purple areas. The purple areas would be based upon where restaurants would actually come. We can't guess where a restaurant's going to buy a building. So installing it in front of a retail store, only to find out two shops down is where the restaurant occurs, you know, we're going to have to wait. So the thought would be that the concept would be there, that parking would be there until you actually have a restaurant come in or want to come in. And then as part of the negotiations with the restaurant, you would say, okay, if you're going to do this in this building, here's what the city's willing to do to help you. Now, there are some of these improvements that we definitely want to do now meaning sooner than waiting for the private sector to make a decision, because we have to initiate. The government has to be the initiator, the catalyst in this. So I don't want you to look at the purple areas or whatever color you see that as being as being the exact locations. Those will float based upon what the private sector decides.
And one of the areas, or some of the areas where we would actually initiate some of that work is very likely to be at the intersections. So here and here, where we're really looking to shorten the crossing distance for the pedestrian. So that would make sense for us to go ahead and initiate those improvements there. However, the ones in the middle, say here and here, as Dr. Woodruff mentioned, could kind of float back and forth depending on where we see some new development activity.
And I would add, even though it's not in the presentation, you can decide how much parking you actually need on that roadway. I mean, that's certainly an ample amount of parking right in front of places. But if you have a high demand for on-street sidewalk dining, you could create a block where that occurs. I don't know if any of you have been to 4th Street in Winston-Salem, but it was a four-lane, one-way road, and we turned into a two-lane road and just brought the sidewalks out. And so along that, you've got nice wide sidewalks, and all the restaurants that are there have folks where they can, and they do, they take advantage during the good weather, they eat outside, you can get a table outside. And they've got a little ordinance, the town set up, the city set up, where you've got a fence, and you know, it's nice. It definitely is a nice field to have. But they didn't have the room to do the parking that you guys do. This actually is better. I've having worked in a lot of downtown studies, I mean, unless you're way up in some really big city, you need to have the parking right there at the facility. So this is actually a better situation than what we have on 4th Street, because you can see the restaurant, you can park there. And it's one thing to be there at 5 o'clock in the afternoon when everybody wants to hang out, but restaurants have to have people all day to be successful. And so, you know, these parking spaces allow someone to go in, pick up something and take it home, or keep on going to another destination. So this is actually superior to that.
We're running a little short on time here, but I do want to make one key point before we move on to the next slide. If you look at these back out areas right here behind the angle parking, that's critical to the function of this design, at least in my opinion. Because what it does is it allows a vehicle to back out into a controlled area that's not a through lane of traffic, and then it also allows them to wait until they get a gap to pull out onto the street. Also, in the meantime, those areas can serve as loading and unloading zones if you have FedEx or UPS come by and you want to drop off a package. So they're intentionally put there for very specific purposes.
I think I've covered all those. Just here's another schematic of how that could look, showing some sidewalk dining. And I won't spend a whole lot of time on it again, more of the same. Your concepts, roundabouts, that's the mini roundabout there. Mm-hmm. And here's another rendering. The gray area, Anthony told me to make sure that that's not concrete. That would be green. It's just hard to make it green on Google Earth, because that's actually an image from Google Earth.
Well, and also notice at this location, there's a reason why we recommended a mini roundabout as opposed to a full-size roundabout. And that is to prevent us from having to buy all these buildings and acquire right-of-way. The mini roundabout fits within the intersection that we currently have. And if you remember one of the first slides that showed the concept, the full-size roundabout fits within the Bayshore and New Bridge Street intersection without having to acquire any property as well. So,
have you all looked at the safety? Have you done any research on the safety of roundabouts?
I have personally been involved with the design and operation of roundabouts for the majority of my career. I've worked for the Department of Transportation for 10 years before I started this firm. And many of the early roundabouts that were done in North Carolina were done up in Winston-Salem, Forsyth County area many, many, many years ago. And just far and large, in terms of a roundabout versus a traffic signal, the severity of the accidents is far less. You do have rear ends, you'd have rear end accident and a traffic signal. What you don't have is high speed angle, you don't have people running red lights. When they're properly installed with the appropriate dimensions to handle traffic volume, then you don't have some of the queuing problems that you have with traffic signals. They are a good application when you study them properly. There have been plenty of them done over the last few years that weren't done properly. And so what happens with a lot of things in transportation is you do it and it becomes a fad, and so people think you do them everywhere. I've never been a fan of that any more than I am of divergent diamonds, which are these interchanges that do this weird stuff. You've probably seen some of those now where you actually make a left turn, the road switches sides. That's a good application in certain areas, not everywhere. The short answer, though, is that in this case, roundabouts, we feel like looking at traffic volumes would not be a problem, actually slow things down, enhance your pedestrian safety, and overall improve the mobility within the area.
And they certainly look better than a traffic signal when everything's all said and done, because the central island, you could, of course, landscape or make some type of decorative paving so that it's not just a concrete median, so to speak.
Yeah, and I mentioned about the mini roundabout, so that could be a decorative thing. You wouldn't plan anything in that one. Right. That would be, you know, the fire engine needs to run over it, they're going to run over it. And part of our experience in designing these things and working with them is that you have to think about not just the aesthetics and the cars, but also the larger vehicles and emergency response and maintenance. Those things are also important. So all those were considered in our recommendations.
Okay. Back to the safety.
Yes,
sir. I really would like to see something that compares the controlled traffic signal intersection with a roundabout.
Okay.
Because I've had experience with them from D.C. to Camp Lejeune, and they've always seemed to have been problems. And there are a lot of complaints about them. And I know ours are single lane, which are a little better than when you have the two lanes where people are, it can get very chaotic. But when you say that you have more severe accidents, that may be true, but you still may have more accidents with the roundabout. But when you have an accident with somebody running a red light, I guess that would be kind of severe. I would like to...
Sure. There's lots of information about that. And like I would say, they're not a fix-all for every situation. There are plenty of places where you need traffic signals where I would absolutely never recommend a roundabout. In D.C., those are actually traffic circles. They're not even true roundabouts, and I can't stand to drive up there on those things because they don't. A roundabout in of itself, inherently, you want slower speeds. The circles in D.C. are so big and in Europe that the speeds get to be pretty high. And once they get to be pretty high, then the severity of the crashes and all those things can go back up.
I have a question for you, ma'am. Mr. Davenport. I've been in Boston, Massachusetts, where they actually have their roundabouts in a reverse circle. So we're not talking about that here for Jacksonville.
Oh, no.
I'm not tracking on that.
I don't know if I've ever experienced
that. I think, Mr. Davenport, I think she just said that the Boston Red Sox fans drive backwards around those circles.
I saw
Yankee
someone.
Fan, I'm not going to pick that up.
I saw someone do that in Greensboro the other day.
So I'm sorry.
Go ahead. No, you're fine.
Ms. Washington, are you talking about a traffic circle where you have two directions of traffic in the same circle?
Yeah.
Okay. That is certainly not what we're recommending. there's one of those in Mayfair down in Wilmington, and I think if we had had our druthers when it was designed, it would have been a traditional roundabout like this versus the what we call a two-way traffic circle.
Yeah. And if you've never seen one before, you would swear that you were probably tripping off of LSD. I don't mean to say that, but I mean, it just throws you off your game if you're not used to it.
It's definitely counterintuitive, to say the least.
We will certainly get the traffic data and the accident data. As Mr. Davenport has said, though, it's almost like anything else. If you put the right thing in the right place, it'll work. If you put the right thing in the wrong place or the wrong thing in the right place, it will not work. Putting a roundabout there at the intersection, go back to the other picture if you don't, at this intersection here.
That one, okay.
You know, because of the low volume, the higher the volume, the radiuses have to change and the clearances have to change. So you have to be very careful. I mean, you would not put
a roundabout up here at the intersection of Hargett and 24. It, even though you have much larger diameters, you know, for your circles, but in this location, it has great potential, and we'll be very happy to get some good examples and some traffic data for you.
Would it be also possible to send this presentation out to our email so that we can?
Yes, sir. In fact, that's what we were getting ready to talk about as soon as John wraps up.
Done.
I think we're at the final slide.
Yeah, we're at the question slide.
Okay. Are there any other questions about the concepts before we move into what our next steps are?
Yeah. I'm a little concerned about you make a resident recommendation, then you survey. And that the, what I would call the stakeholders of the Court Street community weren't really consulted, the business owners, the residents. The whole point of having diverse stakeholders is that you don't just get a transportation point of view. Nothing that you have suggested, well, just with the recommendation, when we go to these conferences, the theme that is promoted most is walkability of a neighborhood.
That's right.
Yes, sir. We are, and Randy reminds us all the time, we're not growing in residential construction. We need to come up with ideas to distinguish and attract residents. Walkability is one thing that does it. With your stakeholders, you're familiar with Lincoln Road and South Beach. Y'all would drive right through Lincoln Road with a two-lane highway, or probably four, with that stakeholder group. You talk about outdoor dining, and that's what that is. Been to Little Italy, Chinatown. One of the special characteristics about those urban areas is the outdoor dining. You get up on Saturday morning, Sunday morning, and they're lining up, the waiters and stuff, setting everything up, because it is the kind of conducive environment to attracting people to that area.
Sure.
I don't see anything in what you have said that would attract people. It'll move cars, but I don't see anything in what you've said that would attract residents to the downtown area.
Are you talking about New Bridge Street, or are you talking about some other street? Because
I'm talking about Court Street.
Okay, because I was going to say on New Bridge Street.
Yeah, you can do that.
Every concept that he has proposed is designed to accomplish what you just said.
Correct.
Okay, I wanted to make sure that.
I thought I started out talking about Court Street.
Okay, I apologize.
Okay, and you know, we have restaurants there. In your design, your recommendation, there's no way you get outdoor dining on Court Street, I don't think. Talking about stakeholders, we formed a committee with the county. And that was one of the interests as a consensus from the committee. Mm-hmm. Closing three blocks. On Court Street, and looking at a pedestrian mall. If you are trying to get to South Court Street, and you're coming from the south or west, you go Oakbridge Street, Ann Street, Railroad Street. If you're coming from the north, you go Cheney Avenue, Railroad Street. If you're coming from the east, you go New Bridge Street, Railroad Street. Very few people go from the safety center on 17 all the way down that way if you're coming from these places. Now, I understand that if you had something developed on Oslo M property, yeah, that would be a direct route.
Right.
I find it hard to see how people could manage to get there if those streets were closed.
Right.
But yeah, it would be a more direct route. But again, you're talking about driving and traffic. You're not talking about the things that are going to add to the attraction and the vibrancy of a community. And I think it's a big mistake to overlook what you could do with a pedestrian mall as far as a very economical way, because we're already on the streets, of extending River Rock Crossing up to New Bridge Street. And you wouldn't have that sight problem because you wouldn't have that traffic needing to look right from being in front of Biagio's. So I just think all that was overlooked by limiting the stakeholders.
Well, and in response to that, we can certainly expand the stakeholder group and go out to the community and start talking about these ideas. But I think, at least from my perspective, the success of a pedestrian mall really depends on where it is. You know, and one of the challenges that we have right here on Court Street is the fact that it's mostly governmental property. So even if we were to create a pedestrian mall, there's only a limited amount of commercial space to serve as a draw. You know, we did talk about the pedestrian mall concept as a group, and we thought that maybe there would be another location for it downtown. You know, we own some property next to the river, which is underutilized at this point. And the research that we've done basically indicates is that you have to have an amenity to bring people to in order for a pedestrian mall to be very successful. So we thought...
Biagio's an amenity?
Well, I think the amenity that they're talking about is that it needs to be near the beach, it needs to be near a river, it needs to be near a major university.
If we had a few more restaurants... to add that variety, if we had a drugstore, the walkability thing is not about being near a beach. It's having things that service that community. But these things would also attract people to an area.
Right.
And so you say it's mostly government. I could count a number of buildings that are available probably right now. We're talking about the homeless shelter relocating, that building. The Roses Five and Dime building would be an excellent building for a Hilda's kind of restaurant. There's a lot of, if you put your mind and imagination to it, there's a lot that could be done, and it's very practical in that area, and it's not all government buildings.
Well, how about if we do this? One of the things that we would like to do is go through the discussion and have you ask questions of Mr. Davenport. Our goal tonight is not to come to decisions. Our goal is to open it up so you can hear Mr. Davenport's presentation, and then on December the 6th to come back and see which of these plans you're willing to say, yep, that looks good, no, I want more study, give us more direction. What we do know is that opportunities are going to occur in the downtown area once the soup kitchen homeless shelter move. So hopefully that's going to be in a year. Whether they will actually get enough money to occupy the building in a year, we will see. But what I'd like to do, very good discussion. What I'd like to do, though, is hold more of that discussion, philosophical discussion, and ask Mr. Davenport specific questions about his thoughts. Because while I value Anthony, we pay him every day. We pay Mr. Davenport to be here tonight, not Anthony. So I apologize, Anthony. But what I'd like to do, Mr. Davenport, what additional comments from your consultant study do you want to make regarding what we've seen so far? And does council have other questions, Mr. Davenport?
I have a comment, if I can, and it may be a good opportunity. Is it possible to provide him the sort of recap notes of the committee notes that we established when we had our downtown committee?
Absolutely.
Because I think as part of this project, and probably the reason you're running into some roadblocks, is I think that downtown redevelopment is more of a comprehensive project and not isolated to looking at just, you know, roadbeds. Or I think, and the view that we took as a group was a little bit more comprehensive. It may be good information for you to have to look at.
and that's all.
Also, let me put that in perspective. After the city and county committee got together, there were specific recommendations that came out of that. The purpose of Mr. Davenport being hired was to look at those recommendations. For example, look at Court Street, open or close. Look at the four-way stop. Look at. So, I mean, they are dovetailed, and if we have misled you as to why he was hired to answer some of the questions that the joint committee came up with.
Dan, you can jump in if you need to. I want to address, you know, from my experience, the closure, because I get exactly where you're coming from. I have been to South Beach, and that, you know, that's certainly a wonderful facility. There are some tremendous distinctions between the two, notwithstanding the beach. You have a high concentration of commercial real estate. And so, and of course, my wife likes to shop, so I know about all the stores in there. I spent 4 or 5 hours on that corridor, ate lunch and dinner there. So I definitely think that environment is, you know, if that's what you're trying to create, I think I understand where you're coming from. The challenge on a short section like what we're talking about now is being able to create the critical mass. So I mentioned 4th Street in Winston-Salem, and I've seen other places, North Wilkesboro, did a downtown study for them and some of these other places. One of the challenges that you have with a small business, because that's generally what's going to go on a street like that, is they have to have all-day traffic. And even with the restaurants on 4th Street, because there's no parking on 4th Street, you can ride by them and see them, but you can't stop. And so they struggle because you don't know where to park. You can see the place, but I don't even know how to get there. And so I'm from Winston-Salem. I know how to get there. So they have a lunch crowd, and they have a decent dinner crowd, but it's not strong enough to have even the major chains look at 4th Street. There is very little retail because of that as well. So the challenge is, if you want to create a pedestrian mall, you're going to have to do, you're going to have to be very intent on what you want to that place to be. And it's going to have to require some investment, as in wayfinding and parking, and this is a mall, and so on and so forth. Even with that, you've got to get something in there that can sustain itself without having vehicles going by or large amounts of people. Because you're not going to have either one of those if you close Court Street. You won't have large amounts of people. You have some walking, strolling, in a park-like environment, more likely, but you won't have any cars. So that is the environment that business has to survive in. So you're going to have to be very deliberate about who you recruit to anchor something like that, so that you can have the type of traffic. So it's one thing to have a coffee shop there, but you got to have enough people in there to be able to take advantage of that coffee shop. And the struggle with the smaller businesses, they just don't get enough pedestrian, vehicle, bike traffic to stay open without having folks going past the door. So not saying you shouldn't consider it, but I am saying that if you are, you've got to look at we work with retailers all over the Southeast. And so what they want to look at is, whether it's pedestrians or cars, they want to know how many people are in that neighborhood. They always have that map. They show how many, they got the circle, 1 mile, 5 mile, 3 mile, how many people they're going to have in the area, potential customers. So that's what you'll have to do in order to make something like that work. You've got to get a market study. You've got to look at it from a perspective of, how do we encourage a business to come here? Can they survive? Can you show them how they can survive without having vehicles in front of them? Those are the type of things that I would encourage you to consider. So I'm certainly not saying that that's not doable. I'm just saying that's the level of energy you're going to have to put into a pedestrian mall.
I would also make one other comment on the pedestrian mall. That's this. This is a section that we would not recommend investing any city money in until the soup kitchen and homeless shelter are relocated. I can tell you that Martin Aragona had two different businesses, good restaurants, out of Wilmington come up here to invest in this block. They both said no. I mean, while we all have a social conscience, we also have to have a business perspective. And until the soup kitchen homeless shelter are moved, you will not get an upscale restaurant. Now, we have two very good restaurants right there right now. I eat at both of them. But I'm telling you, the future for downtown is based upon the waterfront. But the catalyst that's going to have to happen is the relocation of the soup kitchen and the homeless shelter. And that's why you as a council have invested over $250,000 in helping Onslow Community Outreach find a new home. But until they find that new home, you know, we can dream, but it's not going to, private investment is not going to go into those blocks.
I thought we had addressed that with the New River location.
Explain to me what you just said.
I thought the homeless shelter was moving.
They are. The question is when. Because remember, just because you have invested the money and they bought the building, they still are $800,000 short of actually, that's why I say y'all would be commended for taking the first step.
Okay.
The public now has to come together to fund the rest of that project. And hopefully in the next 2 or 3 years, they will do that. And when that happens, you will then have the opportunity to look at significant redevelopment in that block.
So the type of land uses that I would say that would generate traffic, a children's museum. We're doing one downtown Weston. So, you know, that's got kids and coming all the time and moms and everyone playing and whatnot. And so therefore they're in the area. So there's a coffee shop, there's a restaurant, that something like that, some type of land use, a branch of a library, something that's going to drive people there as a destination at the scale that your community is. You know, you're not going to get a, you know, Macy's or whatever down there. So that's not what, but you want something that's going to feel like your community. So some type of land use like that, and you can begin to start looking at what you're envisioning, because that's going to drive traffic. It's going to have a number of visitors that are going to attend there and go there throughout the day, and it's going to create daily traffic. And I think that drives the foot traffic that you need to make something successful.
I think you, I don't think we're talking about the right, the same concept. And I know you're very familiar with what you do. And the mention of Lincoln Road is conceptual. It's not trying to duplicate that. We're not interested in, and it's probably impossible for franchises to come downtown. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about the kinds of restaurants that Dr. Woodruff mentioned, that, who said they're quite successful. We're talking about the kind of restaurants that already are interested in the area, but for the problem that he mentioned. We're talking about making it nicer. And it all goes back to the green thing. Right now, to me, it looks blighted, that strip of Court Street. Even when we made the effort to do the brick,
it
looks like it needs something. But what I'm talking about is something as simple as extending Riverwalk Crossing and the sidewalks to accommodate outdoor dining. I was in Pittsburgh last week. As cold as it is, in December or November, I was surprised to see the extent of outdoor dining in Pittsburgh.
Yeah, but those are Steeler fans. Like
there's a lot of them. There's a lot of them.
I've got family in Pittsburgh, so I plan to be up there on the 1st. It's a wonderful city.
And I just think it's a perfect place to do that and to bring something special that would make people want to live and make it walkable.
One thing, Anthony, that we are doing for Boone, and this is not on a main facility, but more what they would have considered an alley, is this, we call it the Warnerf. It's a facility where essentially the sidewalk and the street all become one. And I don't have an illustration of that with me right this second. You know what I'm talking about, Dan, where they've gone in and essentially the vehicles, the bikes, and the pedestrians all share this space. And it runs parallel to
King Street.
King Street.
It's Howard Street.
Yeah, it's Howard Street is what it is. So you're familiar with that project?
Very much, yes.
And, you know, perhaps something, some feel like that might get you closer to what you're saying. I mean, it still carries traffic, but it's not a, it's not designed to carry a lot of traffic, and it's designed that pedestrians, vehicles, and bikes are all have equal access to the road.
Richard, so other than this part on Court Street, are there other questions for Mr. Davenport about some of his other concepts?
Any other questions?
Here's what we'd like to do is close this session out by saying to you that on December the 6th, which is your next meeting, we're going to come back and show you again, do you concur with what we're proposing in the future for Johnson Boulevard? Do you concur with Cheney? Do you concur? Do you concur? Do you concur? We're also going to show you at that time the four original concepts for New Bridge Street. Now, those concepts were a little different than what Mr. Davenport has shown you. But what we do need to do, because as you have seen across the street, we have now installed the first bulb out and safety islands and really begun to dress that up. We have some money that we have budgeted for a number of years to continue that concept. But at your next meeting, we'd like to actually have you tell us, do you agree with the concept? If you don't agree with the concept, for example, like on Cheney, I'm sorry, on Court, say, fine, let's put that on hold, because what we know is even if we all agreed today that that should become a pedestrian area, it's not time to convert it because of things like the soup kitchen and homeless shelter. So if we can use the next workshop to get focus from you, that's important because your capital improvement program is being put together right now. And one of the things we need to do is, especially here on New Bridge Street, we're coming up at a time where we're ready to start improving water and sewer projects on New Bridge Street, and we need to know what are your thoughts about how you want New Bridge Street to handle. So would that be acceptable for us to close this part out? Yes. Mr. Davenport is certainly available to come back. We enjoyed your presentation, but before we do it, any other closing comments you have?
No, I appreciate you having me here, and appreciate your feedback. And
thank you for
giving us further direction. We'll
and we'll get march a copy on. Of that, Richard.
Yes, sir. We'll get all this to you.
Okay.
So, if we could, let's take a 5-minute.
Let's take a 5-minute
and then
recess.
We'll come back with the wayfinding.
We'll get some food. All right, we're back in session.
The second item that I'd like to discuss with you this evening is the wayfinding or signage program. Glenn has been leading this, so Glenn, please.
Thank you, sir, and thank you, council, and good evening. The point that he talked about signs, so let's give that little definition of wayfinding and not make us all feel so bad about how long this word has been out. It only was coined in 1960 by an architect. And you'll notice that it talks about, it's not just signs, it is maps and other representations of what's used to convey location. Now, there is a Society for Experiential Graphic Design, and this group is the ones that basically are the chief proponents for wayfinding. And this is something that the Mayor Pro Tem knows from his business side. They particularly look to have it that anything that guides people through a physical environment and enhances their understanding of it, which comes to be where we have interpretive signage too, that tells people the story of why it is that you're there. It is the place that the Tourism Development Authority was seeking to have experience for Jacksonville about finding some places out there. And of course, some of those primary destinations are clearly the downtown, the base, any of the transportation hubs, merely because that's a convenience location, the commons and the gateways. And then secondary to that, the components of the base, such as Montford Point, Camp Johnson, New River Air Station, those components, and of course, the Lejeune Memorials, and within downtown to find those by pedestrian, and in our case, sometimes by vehicle, the difference between the courthouse, the Freedom Fountain, some things such as that. And the commons within the commons needs wayfinding, obviously, to point out the three different schools that are there and the components that the city has there. Now, when you're doing this, one of the things that you can do is the use of symbols and carrying your branding throughout the project. Now, you and in 2015, you adopted this as the new city seal. It is part of your official branding of the city of Jacksonville, but it represents the government. And of course, significant to this, it carries the motto, a caring community, which the manager asked me to mention about how far about that goes back. And Mr. Bittner will remember that it was after the first, during the run-up to the first Gulf War, in which the mayor at the time asked to have a group of people meet with some spouses who were anxious about the number of people who were being that were deciding to go out of town rather than stay in town. And on that Monday, after a Friday meeting with the mayor, the Caring Community Committee was formed to try to provide a vehicle by which we could provide support to those spouses so they would stay in town. And that is, of course, one of the reasons why the city of Jacksonville is designated as an All-America City, was the program and how successful it was, and that it also birthed many other projects and brought the Beirut Memorial Project to its completion. This symbol is now the symbol of Jacksonville as a destination. This is what we portray outside of the community, and we can carry inside the community as a point of pride, as what the Jacksonville greater community is and this place that you wish to come to visit. It represents that as the destination with this iconic image that you folks helped to create, as it was. And of course, the slogan that goes with it, "Receive a Hero's Welcome," represents hospitality. Now, toward that, what items will carry this as it was? Well, these types of signs would be signs that would define districts, the downtown district, the garden, such things that, and they're scaled to be with the vehicles in mind. These would give you wayfinding, where it is that you get to those locations and how do you get to them. The larger sign on NCDOT roads, the smaller signs on city roads with less vehicle or traffic. And of course, even that you can take it to the point of street signs and things such as that, and even how to find that that proverbial elusive parking as it is. Then adding direction for pedestrian scaled, you'd have these type of signs, and these signs would carry maps and let people see where they, how far they are, their spatial atmosphere that they are in, and of course it would carry branding as it was too. Now, toward the question that prompted this, talking about gateways, this is how you defined your community as at its boundary. And of course, it carries in a very prominent way the Caring Community motto. And of course, it co-brands this with Jacksonville as a destination and of course, the city seal as it is too. Now, for places where it's very narrow, you'd look at a sign such as this, such as 17 North, in some place where there's not a lot of right-of-way in which to put a sign. You have a vertical that becomes available to you also. Now, promotional signage was something that admittedly caught the eye of many, and we will say that the people in recreation and parks love this part of it. This is where you could have an active sign that would carry messages and that you could change according to what's there. This sign's displaying the Jamboree logo up there. And this sign was proposed for the corner of Western Boulevard and Gateway North, as it was too. Now, toward the end of what Dr. Woodruff spoke of, there has been a design intent document that's been underway for some time, and we are nearing completion on that document. There's some final detail that must go there, but it sets everything out. It gives the locations, it gives where the materials, what type of materials they are to be. It gives the wording for each sign. It provides, as you see from this map then, and in this blow up of one of the pages, where those signs should be, and it's thought out what the front of the sign should look like and the back of the sign, and it's a pretty significant way. Now, one thing that the TDA was excited about was that message sign. And so we've kind of inherited some priorities that the message sign is a high priority, the entrance sign's high priority, and of course, key location signage so we can have people find where are those Lejeune memorials that we're advertising in USA Today magazines and where we're advertising in many other publications. Where are they? How do you find them? Because as you know, there's only sporadic points to that thing, to that location. And of course, there's a $450,000 budget that the TDA has allocated for this project as it is. Now, in addition, you'll notice that the idea is to give direction, to convey your message, particularly that of hospitality, and to share our stories, to tell these stories about why this Jacksonville is such a special place that we all know and love. And we're prepared.
Well, let's go back a second. At the last meeting, there was a comment that the storm had damaged one of our entrance signs. Are we to the point where we can come back at the 6th of December and talk specifically about getting new entrance signs put in the capital improvement budget, and do you like this particular entrance sign? You know, just because the consultant likes it doesn't mean that you as a council, you're the ones who are elected to represent what this city is. So I would like to come back and focus in 2 weeks on the entrance signs, so we can determine, are we going to put them at these six locations, four locations, and is this the sign you want to place?
It is also time. Richard, I think it's important to note that the TDA's funding has already been approved, so we're ready to move forward if the council so chooses that they like the designs and concepts and locations. We've already allocated the funds, so it would have no impact on the general fund. Those funds are coming from the TDA. So that.
But just like the previous discussion, this can be implemented in phases. We need to decide, is this the program you want? If it is the program you want, then we can start to say, okay, next year we will implement the following four signs. This is what it's going to look like.
It's also important to note that it needs to be this comprehensive approach. It can't be, you know, we like this style here and that style there. As you know from your consulting years, most communities are unifying their wayfinding program, so all their signs have the same elements, they have the same features, and they're throughout the city, which makes them attractive.
Go back, if you would, to the entrance signs, just a second, please.
So whatever that ends up being, it needs to all be uniform.
Yep. For example, we will give you dimensions. You can generally see the scale there, but this is not a small sign. If you look at the scale of the vehicle, and let's say the vehicle is 6 feet wide and it's roughly 4 feet tall, you can see that you're looking at something that is of size. And we will show you at the next workshop that this is the sign that we would recommend at the following three locations. And switch to the next sign, if you would. That this is the sign we would recommend at the following three locations. And the difference would be, while they're all gateways, some areas you already own land and you could place this sign.
other areas, you have less land or practically no land, and so you'll be looking at a different style. You won't hurt our feelings by saying, I don't like this. But if we're going to move forward, we have to have these discussions, because once these are installed, this is your branding for the community for the next 20 years. So if you're comfortable, at the next workshop, I would really like to focus on three areas. Your entranceways, the promotional opportunity there at the entrance to the commons.
Yes.
And then get a general feel on whether you like the concepts of the other signs. And we will get this out in PowerPoint so that you can have a connection to study these further.
And just to tie in real quick, Jerry, and I'll turn it to you, it's really important for the TDA work because, as you know, we're progressing all the time with the quality of working with Hinesville County Tourism and everything we're doing to bring people to our community. This is a big part of the, that execution. So when people get here, we need to make them feel like they're at a place, and it looks like a place. And so I agree with you. If we can get some consensus or some direction, if you totally hate it or, you know. But we've got to move forward because a lot of our signs are in bad disarray, and there's no need to spend money on that while we desperately need a unified look and feel to our wayfinding. Jerry?
When did we do away with the Cary community as part of the logo itself?
We did not the city. It's still on the city steel. I mean,
but it's no longer a part of this signage.
Yeah, well, right there, it's at the bottom of this sign.
Yeah, Caring
Community.
I see that.
You would not be able to see it in the seal would have to be too large for you to see it. So that's why, if you remember when we
put the logo on the TDA, right on it too, don't you?
Yeah. The point is that this uses a simplified design of the city seal, so you'd be able to see it, and then you bring out the motto so that you present that in a more fashionable way so you can easily read it.
I understand. My purpose is to keep the logo intact along with the signage as it is.
Well, if you recall, one of the reasons when we presented that to you back in 2015 was that there are some places where you duplicate the city. The city seal was not designed, as you well know, to be everything because it can't scale and you still read it. It becomes very hard to read very small. It becomes very hard to read if you make it too large as it was. And so consequently in this, use the simplified city seal that was in the style guide that you adopted. And then we break out the parts of it that you want to expand upon.
But Mr. Bittner, the kind of guidance we need is, for example, we like everything about this sign, except we want the city seal put up there with Caring Community on the seal, even though we're recognizing you're not going to read it there. If you want the city seal there, fine. The real key is, do you like the rest of the sign? Because a Caring Community is going to need to be in big letters, whether you duplicate it up in the seal or not. But that's the kind of, to be quite frank with you, that's the kind of in the weeds discussion we need to have, because it's time to start getting these things installed.
Well, I guess I'm just used to reading the entrance signs now where the Cary Community and home of Camp Lejeune and the air station stand out as part of that signage. And we're moving away from that. And
But Jerry, no disrespect, you can't read any of that stuff on the sign.
Well, the heck you can't.
Yeah. I mean, you really can't. I mean, I don't think you can. I mean, they're not very visible. It's just not a visible. Here you can clearly see the wording. But we're ready to make, I don't know how everybody else feels about it. Any other comments or?
But that's again, that's the kind of discussion. Mr. Bittner, if you think that it should say, welcome to Jacksonville, home of Camp Lejeune and New River Air Station, a Caring Community, whatever you think, we got to know. Because there comes a point where we're either going to abandon the project and reassign the money, or we're going to come to a consensus as to what y'all want. So we will get these out, and we will show you. What I'd like to do then is concentrate just on two areas, not three. We're going to show you the gateway signs. We'll show you a map of where they're going to go and these concepts. We're then going to show you the sign there at the entrance to the Commons, and then we'll come back and ask you all to tell us, are you comfortable with the locations? Are you comfortable with the style? Are you comfortable with the wording? And if you're not, you know, you're the ones who vote. We need your guidance.
You said when will you do that?
December 6th.
December, okay. Are you, everybody okay with that?
Yes.
Could you get some information, too, with that on the materials involved? I mean, is that going
to
be
brick? Yes, what we'll likely send to you is the design intent document, which specifies all that.
So we'll get that out to everybody?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Any other comments or anything to share? Okay, Richard.
We have quite a number of guests who've already arrived for your 7 o'clock session.
Okay.
I'd like to...
Before that, I have just a couple things, if you don't mind.
That's up to you.
Because I know that Councilman Bittner always thinks that we don't listen to him and don't care about him. So tonight, I wanted to make sure that he understood that we do care about him and that we do think about him. So tonight, I have the official city license plate, which I'll pass out.
Oh, fantastic.
That not just anybody gets, see?
So you can't get pulled with your car with this one?
Well, I'll leave that to Richard.
Yeah. Look at that. I can even read Camp Lejeune and Air Station on there. Care community. And my eyesight's bad.
See, we do think about you.
Thank you.
And I have more that we'll pass out. And then, in addition
to... I'll be kind enough to say that a year wasn't too long the way.
We had to make the plastic.
And then, in addition to, I have these that are available to everyone that would like to have them. So,
okay. All I need is two more vehicles.
I'll make my comment, the birthday cake.
We have heard that more than once.
I ain't real wild about it.
So do you not want a plate?
Yeah, okay. Sure, yeah. I mean, these may be a collector's item. You know, you never know. Well, thank you.
All right. Do we have any other business?
No, sir.
Okay, Glenn, thank you very much. And can I get a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second?
Thanks.
All in favor?
All right.